Should have known what I was going to get back. I said, "The Godfather." Did you expect that to be such a hit? And he said, "I'll do Alec now, doing him." I don't want to talk about movies.
I hope you all have come with some very good questions, because I can't think of a goddamn thing to say to this guy tonight. He and I have talked and talked and talked on other shows we've done, and I just can't come up with anything. I'm very dry this evening. But I do want to say that in a world of talk and talk shows and comedy channels and a lot of good programming and a lot of duplicative programming in this ocean of all this kind of programming, there is one person who, you know, quite some time ago, a few years ago, really distinguished themselves as probably the greatest at this format. I mean, a person who let the pauses breathe and you really felt you got to know the people you were talking to. I mean, many shows, and we'll get into this in more detail, many shows you see these days, it's there isn't a spontaneous moment to be had in front of the camera in a lot of these shows. But with us tonight is someone who really is you know, not just one of the smartest and the wittiest and the warmest and the sexiest and the... Did I get all that right, Dick? But someone who turned something that was fun and entertaining and truly made it into an art form just by the force of his own intellect and his own wits. But without any further ado, please help me welcome the great, great, great Dick Cavett.
I thought it might be funny not to come out and see what you'd do the rest of the day.
I've got some questions here on my phone, as we always do in the modern world here.
Well, put your phone away. We're on stage.
Put my phone away, yeah. I wanted to ask you if you... we were talking backstage, and I was wondering if there was someone, you know, without... You know, because you're very kind, and you're very gracious, and we don't want to embarrass anyone, but... I was wondering if in your format there were people who came out who you really thought what you saw was them, the real them, as opposed to an entertainment figure or any kind of arts figure or political figure, yeah, who was canned and presenting their public self.
There were times when I really wondered, is this the way they are? There were times when I knew how they really were, and they weren't that way on the show, mm-hmm, and that was kind of embarrassing. And then there were times when I was absolutely certain that was who they were. And on my first week, I said to one of them, "I really think you're full of crap." And the network shocked but left it in, because it was to Timothy Leary. Had it been to Spiro Agnew, who deserved it much more, on a later show before he became the other half of the criminal team in the White House.
Won't let that Nixon thing go.
No. By the way, if you haven't seen Dick Cavett's Nixon, Dick Cavett's Watergate, it's now online, so you can if you didn't see it. And it's just brilliant. Sue agrees. And I say that with pure lack of embarrassment, because the people who edited it and cut it made it absolutely riveting. Dick Cavett's Watergate. In fact, I'd go now if I were you. And Google it.
No. What did Leary do that earned him your saying he was full of crap?
I think I remember his line. It was my first week. I was terrified. I thought, how did I get into this? My highest ambition, working for Parr and Carson and everybody, was maybe someday to be a guest on a talk show. Sit in that couch and talk to the host. And then I could go back to Nebraska and say, I made it. And then lead a dreary life of some sort, rather than the rather thrilling one that I've had. But it was Leary. Oh, I know what it was. astute question. He had his book, and he had saturated the nation with his, how'd it go? Tune in, turn on, tune in, and drop out. And he had his new book, and he said, and this is the first time I knew I could be angered by a guest, forget about the Bible. Not that I'm religious, but particularly. Forget about the Bible. This is the new Bible. The Old Testament was just a lot of old kooks on a bad trip. And I said, I think you're full of crap. And the applause was deafening, as it always is. A woman in Kansas wrote that she laughed and dropped her iron on her foot. Because the show, that was daytime then, and it was mostly ladies.
Now, of the people that you interviewed who were, you know, there's Leary calling us now to give us a correction.
Yeah.
I'll pick some of the most familiar names, like Burton and Brando and Lennon and his wife.
She'd love that.
I couldn't help it. I couldn't help it.
It's those two-syllable names.
She lives just a stone's throw from here. I'm sure she can hear us right now. Or we're streaming, right? Maybe she's streaming us right now.
Anyway, you meant to say Mrs. Lennon.
Mrs. Lennon.
Yeah. Sounds silly, doesn't it?
Mr. and Mrs. Lennon. All right. But which of them, I mean, did you think, let's say, I mean, I already had a real affinity for Burton. And when I saw him on your show, God, I thought he was very genuine. Did he seem that way to you?
Absolutely, yes. And if that was phony, then it was a brilliant performance.
Yeah.
I was lucky because he was sober. Now, that may sound crude in some way, but in fact, later reading a biography about it, that was a period when he was desperately afraid of his undoubted alcoholism and was sober for a long, long stretch. And he was... What happened on that show was he agreed to do it, but he said he wanted to meet me, and I met him backstage at Camelot. And we chatted, and then we walked across the darkened stage with the ghost light on its post, and he turned and did a soliloquy from Henry V. I was the sole audience, and I get goosebumps now. Anyway, he did do the show. He didn't want an audience, and it was a half-hour PBS show, and I said, well, why don't you come and do it? We'll have an audience there, and if they bug you or anything, we'll just, or if you decide you definitely don't even want them to see you, we'll just tell them that we've had a technical problem, they'll have to go home. He said, well, I suppose I could. And he came on, and within seconds, he got his first laugh, and every muscle in his face relaxed. He did a second half hour, and then at the end I was rude enough to say, would you do a third one and then a fourth one, and then I chickened out. Too bad. So I have these four great Burton shows. I think they're on YouTube now, probably illegally. The best part was in the fourth one, and I screwed my courage to the sticking place. I didn't make that up.
Yeah, and, no, we know. Yeah.
And I said, would you talk about alcohol? And he was taken aback for a second. And he said, well, I think I've probably said a great deal already about alcohol, and got a laugh. And then something came over him, and he just said, if it would do any good, yes. And for five enthralling minutes, he talks about being a drunk, being alcoholic, the fears, the fight of having to constantly, like an opponent who keeps coming at you, be ready to punch it away. And then he really turned right to the lens and said, you have my great sympathy, my great pity. I'm not going to try to do it for you. But again, if you Google Richard Burton talks about alcohol in my name, you will get it. And it is startling, wonderful moment of tele.
Now, what about Brando, who... I think you're hard-pressed, I think anyone's hard-pressed to tell what his genuine self was. He seems so managing his discomfort when he's on the show. He sits there and he's
Don't you think he must be one of the most complex men ever?
I mean, well, I was going to do a a television movie with him, and I called him. And when you would reach out to him, this is a terrible show business trifle, but you'd call a number, mm-hmm. and you'd leave a message, and a woman would call you back. You'd call like mm-hmm. Carol and so and so, and she would say, "What time will you be available tomorrow?" And Mr. Brando will call you at that time. And sure enough, at 3:30, the phone would ring, and the woman would go, "This is Carolyn, are you there? Mm-hmm. Please hold for Mr. Brando." And he would come on and talk to you. And I said, "I want to meet with you to do we were going to do Cat on a Hot Tin Roof for television. They were going to bribe us and pay us all this money."
With him as Big Daddy.
He was to play Big Daddy. This was many years ago when I was younger. And they wouldn't insure him because of his health. It all came apart. But I said, "I want to come see you before I leave town. I'm going away for several months. I won't have a chance to see you." He said, "When can you come and see me?" I said, "Could I come see you Thursday?" This was like Monday. And he said, "Sure." And I went to his house. It was the most bizarre.
The top of Mulholland.
I went to the top of Mulholland. I go to his house, and he comes in. And I remember saying to him about his weight. I remember saying, when did this begin to you kind of disconnect in that way? And he said that he always wanted to be in shape and be fit and look good for films and to, you know, for his own sexual desirability, you know, meet women and he talked in a very kind of a, you know, very common kind of reductive way about it. You know, he goes, if I needed to straighten somebody out, you know, he thought I wanted to be tough and everything. And then he said something interesting. He said, "I can't do my Brando because I have a cold," but he...
Oh, do it anyway. Your Brando with a cold.
Well, no, he gets up in here like this.
Oh.
And he's way, way, way up in here like this.
Yeah, right.
And very sibilant like this. And he says, "I got into bed and I read books for 15 years. And I went to the same 3 restaurants every night. And I woke up one day and I weighed 300 pounds. And I said, my God, what have I done to myself?" Like it just came on him like an airbag.
Yeah.
Like it just attacked him.
Yeah.
Like it mugged him, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Like it just jumped out of the closet. It was like, whoom, on top of him.
You know? Like a high pressure air hose that he sat
and
on.
He just, and he just kind of didn't.
Terrible.
I mean, we talked about that, how that kind of morphology is due to narcissism, you know, which is you. And he said that to me. Sure. He said, "You look in the mirror and you need to lose 20 or 30 pounds, but you think, I don't look that bad because you have this narcissistic complex." But how did he strike it with you when you off camera?
He went like this.
Right. He led with his left.
Do you know about what I mean by that? He was on my show. Some saw it as pulling teeth on my part. I was so thrilled to have him on. I thought it was great. And I got one nice laugh that relieved me a lot. I said, ill-advisedly, but in a way, should have known what I was going to get back. I said, "The Godfather, did you expect that to be such a hit?" And he said, "I'll do Alec now doing him." "I don't want to talk about movies." We still had quite a bit of time left.
Let's talk about alcoholism.
And he'd been in several movies, as we know. And he said, "I don't talk about movies." So there's a beat, and then you see me say, "Okay, how about the book, The Godfather?" And he looked at me like this, and then went, and then threw that million-dollar grin that he had that will seduce anyone alive. That great Brando grin. My director admitted later that he couldn't cut away from it, even though it was time to cut to another camera. And then that night, the damnedest night of my life, took me down to Chinatown. Ron Galella, paparazzo supreme, you remember Ron? Keep away from Mrs. Kennedy. He pulled up. Marlon was trying to find a restaurant he once knew, but Chinatown was all closed. It was dark. It was like the closed Universal Chinatown set at night with some neon lights. Dark street. Car pulls up. I said, "Oh, God, it's Ron Galella." He had followed us. He said, "What's one of those galore?" I said, "The bigger one." "Just keep the same expression on your face and they'll get tired of taking the same picture." So I said, so we walked for a block with the same expression on our face and felt silly. And nothing worked. And then poor Ron, as it turned out, gave Marlon a chance to do something. He's done at least two films. Do you call it a slip punch or a sneak punch where you're talking politely to the person and then—
Sucker punch.
Yeah, sucker punch, that's it, yeah. And to his troubled mind, it occurred to Galella for somehow to say, "Hey Marlon, take those sunglasses off." He had sunglasses. We both looked arrestable on sight that night. There's a famous picture of us. But what was about to happen was, he said, "Don't you get tired of taking the same picture all the time?" Which he'd said to me. Ron leaned in, and Mr. Brando said, "Don't you get tired of—" And it was like that, came up from the sidewalk, I swear, lifted Galella an inch off the ground. His face went down onto the hood of a car without putting his hands down, which a stuntman can't even do. And he had broken the jaw, and...
sounds awful.
Yeah, it was terrible. And you know, but there, you know, the nice thing is that I couldn't keep a straight face.
No, no.
The nice thing is there aren't people like that around anymore.
There should be a law against that.
Later I asked him about it. I put him into the hospital. I had breakfast with him. His bed was as bloody as the bathtub in, what's the movie with Maria Schneider?
Tango.
Tango, Last Tango, which was playing at the time. We passed the marquee coming up from Chinatown. His hand was the size of a grapefruit, and a doctor, so-called, a hotel doctor of some sort, probably Thomas Mitchell, you know, if I could just have a little drink before I... And it was sewed up with black thread from the hotel. And it was oozing in red lines.
Marlon's hand?
Yeah. It was just a pamplemousse size hand. And he said, "Oh, I've had it before, I'll have it again." Called my doctor. I didn't even finish describing it. And he said, "I don't care if he's naked. Get him over here right now." He was in the hospital for 3 days. I went and visited him and stuff, of course. Oh, I made him laugh. I came in and said, he was lying in the bed, and I said, "Al Pacino's going to come over and roll you down the hall in a few minutes." And Marlon laughed, and it gladdened my heart. But you owe me several films that he made later, I think. He could have died with that hand, I was told. So.
Now, Lennon, I think you mentioned, and Yoko Ono, if I may, are on your show. And you did a few with him, correct? You did more than one?
Well, I did a 90-minute-er, and then they asked if they could come on again and do a song. And so they did come on again. Actually, Shirley MacLaine came on in that show with them.
And the thing about that is that when you talk to people, you know, I've been doing this podcast for WNYC, and I'm just about to start doing it again.
They're finally got wonderful. The funding.
I did you.
Yeah, I know.
And we got some funding to do it again. We're going to launch, I guess, in November.
Great.
And the reason I do it is because, you know, the longer format, I think people can say some more interesting things. And sometimes you think, you wrestle with, well, do I bring on this person who always has a microphone available to them? There's no shortage of opportunities for them to talk. And I wonder, did you get a sense, Lennon, who is obviously one of the most famous human beings that ever existed in history.
Yeah.
What else did he want to get off his chest that he hadn't said before in the prior 10 years or more of his fame?
You do sort of wonder that. When people say that idiot question, what was he like? I always think of my great old philosophy professor, Paul Weiss, at Yale, who looked like and talked like a Brooklyn cab driver and could think down any 10 men. And he'd been on my show talking about religious things or something. Rex Reed came out, sat down by him and said to this great metaphysician, what is God like? And Paul Weiss, to his credit, said, well, that's a difficult question because he isn't like anything, he's unique. You can't say what was he like. Whenever I'm said, what was he like? I'm gonna think, well, he was, What do you mean? Was he like an umbrella, like cheese, like the Eroica Symphony? Like is a word we should strike.
But we're going to talk backstage. No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go. I slid off your question.
We talked backstage, and we're going to get into the mechanics of the show. But oh, yeah. How does Lennon come on the show? He doesn't call you, or did he call you?
Someone, maybe Sue, or someone less astute than Sue on my staff, checked, and they were willing to, as they say, let the entertain the idea of coming on, and or let it entertain them, I guess I was going to say. And then they said, they want to meet you. I went to the St. Regis. They were on the bed in a big suite, not like that. John had work, a lot of folders and projects laid out, put me in a movie briefly with a 16-millimeter camera, and I guess the word I've been looking for with to describe him is accessible. He was, as Mr. Groucho Marx was, so easy when you met them that you feel you'd known them. And John was that way with me, at least, and undoubtedly others. I wanted to make him laugh for some reason, and he said, you know, you've got the only halfway intelligent talk show on television. And I said, why would you want to come on a halfway intelligent show? John laughed, as in Garbo laughed, if you're old enough. And we got on great, and they came on the show. He puzzled some people early on in the show by suddenly saying, Dick, what's your definition of love? That was his David Frost, whom he loathed, and so did my friends from beyond the fringe for as being a notorious material thief. But they were nervous. Why would they be nervous? They killed a package of Viceroys in the first 2 cents. We can see the shows. But they were, John was very personable. I lost in a fire, so I can't be blamed. 2 letters from him, single space type, and they were like reading James Joyce, who was his hero. Literarily, but he was a great guy, and thanks to our insane gun laws, he is no longer with us.
Yeah.
Well, you have to say one thing for the NRA. They have made it convenient for every lunatic to get a gun without any inconvenience at all, and that's kind of a remarkable
thing. Now, we have your former colleague and my former colleague, Ron. I want to credit Ron Fried, who's here. Ron had some smart questions here.
Uh-oh.
And
he knows too much about me.
Exactly. I wanted to come with some drones here that I could get in on you. and he said that you interviewed Hendrix, Joplin, Grace Slick, Lennon, the Stones, everyone. He writes, but honestly, Dick, have you ever once in your life listened to a rock record for pleasure?
Oh, Ron, how well you know me. I never gave a damn about rock music, and I had them all on the show, partly because I think when early on Janis came on, she loved being on, she came on 4 or 5 times, and maybe she said to some of them, it's okay to do Cavett. That wonderful moment with her.
When she said it's okay to do Cavett, is it okay to do Cavett or is it okay to do Cavett? Because that was my follow-up question.
Yeah, you want to move on to the next?
Yeah.
What was that question?
Did you and Janis Joplin have a special arrangement?
No.
No?
No. We had the usual arrangement. You know, I've never said that before.
It's here, right here, Ron Fried.
That would made Richard Nixon say, then Cavett's a real man.
Yeah, yeah. Chelsea Hotel.
You want to move on?
Is it true?
I haven't said anything.
Okay. Yeah, you haven't said anything. I'll do all the inference here.
How dare they give us a falling coaster?
Now, how is it that Lennon helped you book a stair?
You know, I don't know, but he did.
He did. And he ran into a stair?
Well, when I went to the St. Regis on this horribly rainy day to meet the Lennons in my work shirt, and I was half sort of wet, and Esther had just been in there, because Yoko, you know her, had met him in the lobby. John's making a fantasy movie, she said. Would you come up to the room and do a dream sequence where we dance? And he had. And that's the connection of the two of them.
So what is the what was the day like? Did you spend the whole day there?
I stayed for a long time.
It was a long day.
Yeah, and he put
writing.
He put me in a film where he had four or five men, maybe a stagehand or something, and you whispered a story to the guy next to you. And that came out in a rather famous, I think, our film of John's that I've never seen, but I've heard a lot
about
it. But
I mean, aside from Lennon, when you did the show itself, what was the day like to shoot the show?
Well, everybody was all uptight and nervous and wanting to, not knowing whether they should touch him or talk to him or how he would be and all. And
I'm not talking just about Lennon. I mean, any of the shows. When you were doing the show at that time, what was the day like? Long days, a lot of writing, or did you just come in and just zip it off and you were out of it?
Well, Jack Parr set the pattern for the talk show, and everybody else did it that I ever worked with, Merv, John, everybody, which was to have a staff of people who were called talent coordinators. Later, they raised in their own esteem their image and called themselves segment producers. But anyway, they were talent coordinators, and they would meet with the guest if the guest would be met. Some said, I know Dick, or I know Johnny, I don't have need anybody, I don't have time. At the other extreme, Lucille Ball sent me 2 hours of tape cassette of what we might do and talk about. Other guests just came on, both were good. But so you'd get some guest notes, and they would say things like, he just had a funny incident in a cab, it has to do with a dog. Ask him about his mother, she writes him all the time, and that sort of thing. He wants to talk about religion or whatever. Mr. Astaire would rather not talk about his origins in Omaha. Interesting. And then Jack said, a kid, you know, later when he was telling me how to do a talk show, he said, the first thing you can do with your notes is forget them. Maybe the best thing. But I was so scared at the beginning. Oh, Alec, I rigidly asked the next question, until a friend said, did you hear the answer you got that you dropped? It wasn't this, but it was this bad. A guest had said, I think, something like, let's say, and then we opened the old rusty trunk, and you'll never guess, clearing the sand away and lifting the lid, what was inside. And I would say, do you have any hobbies? It was almost that bad, because I was just in here. I couldn't come out.
And how did that change?
I don't know. I'll tell you how. James Mason came on an early show, and he was so charming and so interesting in what he talked about that I forgot there were commercials. I was just talking to him the way we're talking, and as if we were off stage talking. And then I realized the lesson Jack had tried to give me. A few weeks before I did the first one, daytime ABC, kid, whatever you do on the show, don't do interviews. I thought, do I sing or read Philip Larkin poems? What do I do? He said, no, interviews. You know, that's Q&A and what's your favorite color and David Frost and his jet lag and his clipboard and let me ask you this and what's been your most interesting experience? Make it a conversation, he said. And that makes the difference. As you know, when you came to my house and we talked endlessly.
Yeah, but when you became, and this to me is interesting, when you became, you know, this sensation, because it's, you know, it's a smart talk show and people become this sex symbol and people want to...
Talk about that.
Yeah, I want to talk about... Well, I find that interesting that the show on ABC when you were with Dick and with Bob and the band and everything ran how many years? 5?
The band?
No, that show, the ABC show, the nighttime show.
Oh, how many years? Started in the morning in '68. They replaced Joey Bishop with me, and that lasted until somewhere in '75, and then 5 years after next on PBS. With a year on the USA Network and then CNBC and...
But the nighttime one on ABC lasted how long, 5 years?
Five to six years.
Five to 6 years. Yeah. And so during that time, you know, one of the things I was wondering was, how was New York itself different?
It was. The feeling is entirely different. I don't know, I can say all the things about it. First of all, there was, you could get somewhere in a cab, you can't anymore. And I don't know, audiences seemed just wonderful then. I had sneaked. And we invited a whole lot of them here tonight. That's a,
yeah.
What a faux
pas. We're having a reunion show.
What a fox pass, as a friend of mine said.
Fox pass.
Who was not very good in French class. See, I used to come down from Yale, and people thought I was gay, my roommates, because when everybody went to Smith, Vassar, and Wellesley for the weekend, I went to New York and sneaked into the Jackie Gleason show and the Gary Moore show and What's My Line and Mr. Peepers. And I thought, why would anybody want to go meet girls when you could see television shows? Fortunately, this changed in time. I don't know how different New York was, but boy, was it. It was just a different feeling. And I don't know how you'd create it in a movie now. I miss Times Square. There's something called Times Square still there.
Yeah.
But all that garish neon crap and light, special lights and stuff. When I want to see the old Times Square, I have to watch Sweet Smell of Success.
Yeah.
Because it's shot all around there. And there's the dance hall and the Translux and the clothing, the Bond clothing sign.
When I want to see the old
Times Square. The smoking sign.
When I want to see the old Times Square, I go back on YouTube to watch the opening of Million Dollar Movie.
And they oh, play yeah.
Gone with the Wind, you know?
Yep, yep.
Yeah, I remember, I always tell people this story. I say, this is what YouTube, including your show, because I'm someone who, if I'm insomniac, which is quite often, I stumble down multiple stairwells and down multiple corridors of YouTube. I get lost in the YouTube vortex.
It's a time machine. Yep.
And I was telling somebody how, when I was a kid and you'd watch the old WOR, this is back when they had booth announcers. And before everything was computerized and programmed, they had a man or a woman live on a hot mic in a booth because they'd have technical difficulties. And these very velvety announcers would come on. There was one guy who I said to someone, and I wasn't being coy or whatever, or glib, I said, this guy was the voice of my childhood. He was the voice of my childhood. When I was a boy, you'd lay in bed and you'd watch Million Dollar Movie, and the guy, or before Million Dollar Movie, this guy would come out and they would give you a preview of what was coming. He was live at a mic.
Wonder who it was.
I'll tell you his name. It took me 6 months to find out this guy's name. But they'd come on. It would be like, let's say the movie was Ball of Fire. And this guy would come on and go, next on Million Dollar Movie, Barbara Stanwyck tells Gary Cooper where he can go. On Ball of Fire.
He can do anybody's
voice. And this guy's voice haunted me. Mm-hmm. And for 6 months, I went and found out that his name was Robert Molly. Robert Molly was one of the booth announcers of WOR.
Not Ludwig van Voorhees.
Van Voorhees.
You know, Arthur Godfrey smashed up in his car accident in his early career, listening to the radio, created a revolution that was half his success. He listened to radio, and those velvet-voiced announcers, did you just say, good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the radio audience. Or, ladies and gentlemen, all of you out there. And he said, they should never have said any of those things. Why didn't they say you? You don't address a crowd. Every ditzy hostess and host on certain shows, can a man be ditzy? Invariably say, hi, everybody. That doesn't reach you. But Arthur, who came on with that great voice, this revolutionary idea, and said, how are you? Good morning. Hello, how are you? And my grandmother and every lady her age up and down thought Arthur talked to her. And he had such a hold on the country that when I walked on a hot day in Nebraska with no air conditioning, past house to house, you never missed a word of the Arthur Godfrey show. Just a wonderful, incredible.
So when this was all happening to you, and you had this great success, how did it feel? What was it like?
What was it similar to? What did it resemble?
What would you compare it to?
I never really had time to think about it. And I thought, what do I do if people come up to me on the street and stuff? And I had been on it months or so, and it didn't seem like anybody had. Mr. Woody Allen said, Cavett, you really have to be on a long time before they start recognizing you. And then that did start. And then, but more in answer to what you're saying, I think I had felt I had gone through the looking glass, and people I worshiped from our TV, in front of our TV set in movies as a kid were now sitting next to me.
Yeah.
And I thought, what happened to me? How did this happen? This is Robert Mitchum sitting here. This is Katharine Hepburn. This is Orson Welles. Could it be the real Orson Welles?
Right.
And even a fake Orson Welles would be interesting, but it was very, very strange. And when people said, we love you and stuff, I still thought, how do they know me? I'm Dick Cavett from 23rd Street in Lincoln, Nebraska. I'm not supposed to be here.
So you just had an automatic, which is very common with some people who are very talented. Usually it's in direct proportion to them being talented and famous, where they just have a natural, just a neurological condition that they just deflect all that. They don't really let it get to them.
Some can
fame.
Do that, yes. Some can be unrecognized if they want to. Miss Ingrid Bergman, you know, the famous actress, walking down Fifth Avenue with a New York Times guy, and he said, Miss Bergman, it's odd, we've walked three blocks and no one's recognized you. And she said, oh, well, do you want to see me recognized? And she did a different walk and a different angle and a familiar one, and everybody saw her and said hello. It's an odd thing. Groucho Marx had been, Groucho's God was the great Georges Kaufman. Kaufman died. By coincidence, I met Woody Allen the night before. We said, let's go to Kaufman's funeral. He was also Woody's God. And I went and Woody didn't. Frankie Campbell. They put us in a little ante room. It was such an overflow. And this was a milestone, what happened next. I looked across this little ante room with maybe 8 to 10 people in it, and one of them was Groucho, was Julius H. Marx, better known as Groucho, with a cigar, unlit, very reverent looking. I stared at his profile. My dad wouldn't let anybody talk when Groucho's radio or TV shows were on. And then I thought, I guess I'm going to meet him. And this meant so much to me. Years earlier, at about age 12, I was in Hollywood visiting friends, relatives, and I went to Farmer's Market, the booths, and it was a chicken leg booth, and I bought a chicken leg, and they said, hey kid, you should have been standing here. You know, like 2 minutes ago, Groucho Marx was standing right here. That's how I knew there was no God. If I hadn't stopped to pee, if I hadn't stopped to tie my shoe, I'd have met Groucho Marx, and the fates made us meet. But here he was. He walked to the corner of 86th, beautiful day, and on the way out of the name crowd of the theater world at Kaufman's funeral with Moss Hart doing the eulogy and saying, I can hear George in the coffin saying, needs cutting. I heard, hi Groucho, I'm Edna Ferber. And I thought, you're not in Nebraska anymore, Toto. Went to the corner, and in an example of my witticisms, I said to him, Groucho, I'm a big fan of yours. And he graciously said, well, if it gets any hotter, I could use a big fan. That was the beginning of our friendship. We walked down Fifth Avenue, the Puerto Rican parade, unlikely. Groucho insulted every doorman on the way down. And then in the voice from the game show, as he always called it, you bet your life, he said, well, you seem like a nice young man, and I'd like you to have lunch with me. And we went into the Oak Room of the Plaza, and all through lunch, I thought, they can shoot me after this, I won't care. Yeah. I got to tell my friends about it. And then we were friends for years. He would call me and say, do you want to go to a movie when he was in town? Do you want to? leaving a snooty Beverly Hills dinner party one night, Groucho had enough, opened a French door, let's get out of here. And the hostess came over and said, leaving so soon, Mr. Marx? Groucho said, I've had a wonderful evening, but this wasn't it. How could you not love a man like that?
Now, people today, we're going to take some questions in a little while, but people today who do talk shows, which in my, you know, you talk about, you know, What's My Line and those kinds of shows. I mean, I'm not embarrassed to say that's when I stumble down that YouTube corridor, that's one of the hallways I go down. I'll watch 10 episodes of What's My Line because you just can't believe how people who were the biggest stars, they're sitting there in this this dais of these clever and witty, you know, Bennett Cerf and all these people are there.
Arlene.
And Robert Yarlene.
Miss
and Robert
Dorothy
Q. Lewis.
Kilgallen.
Dorothy Kilgallen and all her craziness. And some of the mystery guests, will you enter and sign in, please?
G.A.
Gary Cooper. Gary,
that's what I was going to say.
Gary Cooper.
Yeah.
And you sit there and go, oh, I mean, and you feel, watching the show, you like relive it. You don't, you don't know Gary Cooper from a hole in the wall.
And you only saw the hand in the blackboard until it spelled out William Holden, Groucho Marx.
Oh, my God. Frank Sinatra.
Frank Sinatra. Ed Wynn. And
everybody did that show.
Does it sound strange to you that I was on What's My Line? It does to me. Because
when?
I watched it in Lincoln for years. And my manager, the legendary Jack Rollins, who managed Nicholson May and Woody and a lot of people, ran into the producer and said, you know, I got a new kid. He's a comic working in the Village. I think you should put him in the rotating now Fred Allen chair, because they never replaced Fred Allen with someone permanent. And I woke up in my dream, standing backstage with Miss Dorothy and Bennett Cerf and in my tuxedo, and I was on What's My Line. We work alone. And you want to hear my laugh that made me realize the gods loved me? Bennett Cerf, John Daly said to me,
John Daly.
We're going to start with you, Mr. Cavett. And we're blindfolded, and the mystery guest's there. And the applause was so great, and I felt so out of place, that I heard myself say, I have a feeling the mystery guest is trying to figure out who I am. Utterly unknown. And that got the laugh that relaxed me.
Well, mystery, no, go ahead.
You might like this because of that show. Stan Laurel, whom I can't believe I met, and there's two nice columns in the book about meeting him at his house, his apartment. And he said there was one television show he couldn't stand, and it was What's My Line? And he said, why? And he said, I call it the snob family. And there were certain people who didn't like it, certain estimable people who didn't like it. But gee, I could watch them like you all afternoon.
Well, people, when you look at talk shows now, and I don't want to disparage talk shows now, but I mean, they serve their function, and for the most part, you are compelled when you're marketing a film or some product you're doing, or, you know, a project, a book, what have you, a television show they want you to, or a music act, they give you a list of like 100 things, you know, if I do a film.
Yes.
If I do a film, they give you a list that you cannot even conceive of how long this list is, and say pick some quotient of NPR and the USA Today and this talk show. And so you do these things, and some of them you do, because you just, you know, admire the people. Like Letterman is always so kind to me, and he's always been so great to me. Yeah. And all of them, by and large, but you don't you jump out of bed and say, oh, I want to go on a talk show, you know. And but they've changed, obviously, over the years. And, you know, when I think about Carson, I've got two questions for you. When I think about Carson, the gag was the kind of disparity of the guests. And my friends and I used to smoke pot and sit there and do our Carson lineup to crack each other up. And of course, if it was someone that the general public didn't know, you had to have some little identifier at the end. So they say, Johnny's guest tonight, Shields and Yarnell, Don Drysdale, Senator Daniel Inouye, Democrat of Hawaii. They have a little
little underestimation.
But it was all over the place. You know, Carl Sagan, yeah. Tony Fields,
yeah.
Muhammad Ali, sports, science, this.
Yeah.
Michael DeBakey. You know, freaky, 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 discordant thing.
It was hard making the transition from guest to guest sometimes.
Right.
And here's a truism. If you're a comedian and you're going on a talk show and you're nervous as hell backstage and somebody ahead of you talks about the death of their child with a hideous disease and something.
Or a lynching. Just,
yeah, or yeah. A nice lynching, yeah. You will probably do better than you would have if you followed chatty Dinah Shore onto the show. And I asked Johnny once, what is that? I was so scared. I heard backstage and I went on with you and I didn't want to let you down, but that woman was talking about the death of her mom. And he said, they want relief. They want relief from the sadness, and it worked. And when the man, too long a story, but the man who died on my show during taping.
How many people don't know this story?
Don't know?
Okay. Tell them about the man who died on your show.
How's that? Okay, I'll make it quick because.
No, don't.
No, I want to ask it. Okay. I want to whisper a favor. Can I do the Jack Benny story? I can do it in a minute just before we go to questions.
Yes.
Yeah, they can't hear us. But,
yeah, they can't.
Okay. So, the cover of the New York Times book review, a magazine back then, had a picture of a great man who was rather famous for his works and publishing and stuff, named J.I. Rodale. Somebody, maybe Sue, said, let's get this guy. Somebody fell out. We need a guest. So he came on, and you already know the punchline in a way, but you know, whom would the gods have die on a talk show except a health expert? And that's what whatever gods may be decided to do. He was very funny. J.I. Rodale, you know, Rodale Publications, Today's Health, all those health magazines and things. And he was quite funny. And I made a mental note to have him back. We passed the 12:30 mark. The next segment, Pete Hamill came out, about columnist. And suddenly Rodale made and went back like that. And now there's some dispute as to whether I said, are we boring you, Mr. Rodale? Dead man and we're laughing. I knew he was dead, and found myself holding his wrist. I got up. I thought, I'm in charge here. I have to deal with this. And everyone was kind of, many were laughing. I thought it was a bit because he'd been funny. And you know, comics on a show would snore when their friend was on, and then, oh, sorry. It wasn't that. Later, when Miss Hepburn had me over to her living room to talk about maybe doing my show, she sat down on the floor with long legs and said, I want to hear everything about the man who died on your show. And so I had to tell this there. Her dad was a doctor and she gave pills to everybody on sets, movie sets. You know, so I told her about it. And the strangest thing was the audience realized he was dead, it seemed by row. Because, after all, it's a television show, people in makeup, there's a band, everybody's happy, laughter. You don't have a dead man in the middle of that. And I said to Kate, as I was allowed to call her after a time, why do you suppose I went to the edge of the stage and said the following words, is there a doctor in the audience? And I made that pause, and she said, well, you knew that if you said, is there a doctor in the house, you'd get a laugh, and she was right. Because still, half the audience thought, this isn't what we came to see at a show. Two stewardesses were crying in the front row, as we were allowed to call them. In the front row, they knew immediately it was a dead man. Two interns were in the audience, and Patty's on the floor now, his pants open and pounding his chest. But he was DOA at Roosevelt Hospital. And the staff looked at it the next day, and none of us had remembered that he had said during his appearance, one thing you never want to say, I plan to live to be 100. Because of his health. And later somebody said because of his health practices, he had a rheumatic heart as a kid, and he was told he would live about 15 years. So you got to say something for that. And he had also said, I never felt better in my life, which we know is always a bad thing. But that was a hell of an awful experience. And to bring it around,
Benny,
I thought I could never do a show again. It was in all the papers. How do I go out tonight and do my monologue? I called Johnny. And I said, what are you doing? He said, Richard, you go out and do the show. You talk about it at the beginning. And I said, but then Phyllis Diller comes on. And dear Phyllis came on and killed him. People who were sobbing at my description of that. But I guess, would you think I'm the only person in the Guinness book, Alec, who has had a guest croak on the show, to put it bluntly?
I told you, I went to a Broadway show.
Oh,
and Adam Market is standing down there. He's doing the Margulies play, Brooklyn Boy, and he's downstage like this, and he has a scene with the ghost of his dead father. And the actor comes on who's playing his father, and he's going to have the ultimate moment, the final moments of the play. And I'm sitting house left, ninth row, a woman down, house center, in the fourth row, stands up, starts to walk to the aisle, and collapses in the aisle. And an older man, she's an older woman, and an older man gets up, and a younger woman to attend to her. And I'm sitting watching, and Adam Arkin's doing the scene, and he's looking at this playing out in the aisle of the play. And he's doing the scene with his dad, and his dad would talk, and he'd look down to see what's going on. And I wait about 10, 15, 20 seconds, and I get up, and I walk down to see if I can help. And the man has his back to me, he's bent over the woman, and the man, I told you this, the man turns up to me and goes, it's my wife, I think she's dead.
Probably the best line
like,
in the play.
Like, he got a ticket. He was like, you know, they say my registration's expired. I got a ticket. It was the most nonchalant thing I've ever heard. It's my wife, I think she's dead. And I literally, I don't know what came over me. I pushed the man, I go, get the fuck out of my way. I pushed the man out of the way, and I pick up his wife, and I carry her out to the manager's office. She was a little spindly woman. And I carry her, and they lay her down, and they get an ambulance to come and take care of her. She wasn't dead. And he was hoping. There was some Charles Boyer thing going on there with her. He was giving her something in that.
Could this be a textbook case
in
of
that
wish fulfillment?
Yes.
Yeah, wow.
You should be so lucky. What were you going to say about Benny? Yeah.
There's another guy the next day saying, I thought she was dead, but no. Well, Benny.
Benny.
Okay, I've told so many Groucho stories, and I feel I neglect Jack Benny sometimes. I was in hog heaven when I got the job on the Parr show, because I stayed for every taping. And then watched it at night, and I had never missed a Parr show in my real life before that, I don't think. And the hog heaven part was in the dressing room, in the green room, in the makeup room. I got to talk to my gods. Bob Hope, Jack Benny, George Burns, Sid Caesar, you can name more. Jack Benny, notorious for working the cleanest in vaudeville, and also, really, in his radio and television show, was the nicest man in the business, perhaps. I never met anyone who could think of anything bad about Jack Benny. Benny Kubelski from Waukegan, I think it was, yeah. And one day, the show ended, Tonight's Show, and we walked to the elevator, and he got in, and it was the elevator supposed to keep tourists out of, just for the stars. But five or six civilians got in with him and with me. And before we'd left, I hope there are people old enough here, one or two, to get these references. Before we left the seventh floor, somebody had said, are you really cheap? And somebody else said, do you really play the violin badly? And somebody else said, is it true you don't pay Rochester no money? And the Maxwell, do you still drive the 1950? They got them all. And he's such a sweet man, and he would nod, and you know. And then they all rushed out on the main floor to tell their friends what had happened. And I said, Mr. Benny, after all these years, those same things over and over, doesn't it get tiresome? And he put his hand on my shoulder and he said, you know, kid, sometimes you just want to tell them to go fuck themselves.
Let's stop right there.
Is that a sweet story? Okay.
A question you have here is, after the Gore Vidal and Mailer set two, did you ever have a reasonable relationship with Mailer after that?
I did, in fact. I liked Norman, and that was the damnedest show I ever did where nobody died. I got to get that out for people who haven't seen it even once. But yeah, Norman came to gut Gore about something he'd written about him, and I'm, in a way, I'm sorry to say, the key of the dissension that grew up like in a play, tighter and tighter, is on YouTube, where Norman was insulting to all of us, and at one point he said he was superior to us in some way, and I said, in what ways? And he said, intellectually superior. And I said, perhaps you'd like two more chairs to help contain your giant intellect. And that got a laugh just like that. And then Norman, humor was pretty much left out of Norman. Gore, of course, could slaughter him, and so could the great Janet Flanner, who was on the show, a lady. Letter from Paris for years, a friend of Hemingway's and Gertrude Stein. Everybody was piling on Norman, but he went too far with me when, after that remark I just told you, he said, Cavett, why don't you just read the next question off the question sheet? And I thought, I am not David Frost. And I said, heard myself say, why don't you fold it five ways and put it where the moon don't shine? Well, they loved it. And it's always misquoted as stick it where the sun doesn't shine. That's vulgar.
Yes, totally different.
Yeah.
It's completely different.
That was a hell of an evening. What was the thrust of the question? I forgot now, but.
Did you recover your relationship with Mailer after?
Oh yeah, yeah. He was on shows later. Gore was on shows later, even though Norman had headbutted Gore in the dressing room before the show. On that show, a sentence felicitously phrased in the English language got a hand. I think I have it almost 100%. Norman said, Gore, after Gore had gotten a big laugh, could you just talk to me instead of sucking up to the audience and trying to get yucks out of the audience? Could you just talk to me? I believe Gore said, I'd be happy to talk only to you, Norman. But as luck would have it, we don't happen to find ourselves in the friendly neighborhood bar, but by election before a studio audience, and it would be dishonest of us to pretend otherwise. And the audience clapped. Good sentence.
Now, speaking of election, this is a very ham-fisted jerk of the wheel here. Mm-hmm. Have you ever had any political aspirations yourself?
None in the slightest.
Never.
No.
And are you political in the sense of supporting candidates and causes and?
Yeah, not as much as your noble work and that sort of thing. But I have. I was urged to go into politics on the air by Jerry Rubin. How many remember the Chicago 705? Yeah, he came on in the judge's robes. And then wadded them up and stamped on justice, do you get it? And then in the show he said, Kevin, you know, you ought to use this show. You're wasting your time. You should use this show only for political purposes.
But was there a political figure, whether he was on the show or not, that over your lifetime you really admired and you really felt they were doing all that for the right reason?
Oh yeah, quite a few during the unpleasantness in Vietnam. Yeah, I'm blanking on a name.
Is McGovern on the show?
McGovern was on. They were all on.
Muskie. Oh,
who? Yes, Muskie. The first time politics came on was my first week, and I'd never thought ahead. What do I do if a controversy arises? And he was a lawyer who wrote readable books about the law. What was his name? Someone will yell it out of that time. And
novels?
Well, no. Perhaps if we use Freud's technique and try to put it
out of Effley Bailey? No.
No, an older lawyer. Louis Neiser, thank you. Go to the head of the class. Give that man 10 silver dollars.
Get the hell up here.
Yeah. What are we doing up here when he's down there? Well, he came on and began to spout apologia for the Vietnam War. And I hadn't thought much about the war enough. And it went on. And I said, can I ask you a question? You've been talking about how close you are with Lyndon Johnson. Isn't he the man who said, this is a war for Asian boys? And he sat just as you're sitting. He was not used to being challenged in any way, and I continued to do so. And that was the first time that came up. Later somebody said, oh, I'm Neiser, for Christ's sake. He was dying to get on the Supreme Court, and he was kissing Johnson's ass, and you know, so I didn't know that at the time, or I'd have maybe pointed it out, I guess. But yeah, oh, and I forgot to tell you about Jerry Rubin. He said I should do only politics. And I said, but politics bores my ass off, which is largely true. And ABC was going to censor that. But again, because it wasn't to a Republican right-wing person, but to a marginal like Jerry Rubin, they left it in and kind of liked it. No, I don't want to be in politics. Bad enough having to see it.
Someone writes here, we have a viewer who writes, who's written in, let's do this also. We have a viewer here who's written in.
There's that voice.
I was always in awe of how relaxed you were chatting up the luminaries. Hmm. I recall, however, that Noel Coward made you a little unsettled. Any comment?
Coward was, of course, fabulous. My late wife and I were at a party in London given by Louis McGraw, one of the former George S. Kaufmans and the one he loved the most. And she said, Mrs. Lunt called me the other day, Mrs. Alfred Lunt, of course, and said something and about Dick Cavett. And I said, well, I know Dick. I know his wife. We did a play together. And she said, Lynn Fontaine was heard through the phone saying, Alfred, Louis knows Dick Cavett. Through the looking glass again. Anyway, we talked, we had a dinner together, and they came on the show. And Mrs. Fontaine called me a week before, like, the Lunts are really coming on. Nobody could believe it, theater folks especially. She said, could we bring a friend? And I said, well, of course, you know, we've got some seats right down front. She said, well, it's Noel Coward. And I thought, well, we could pencil him in and, you know, maybe he'll get on stage. He was terrific. Introducing him, I remembered something, the way you will on a show that you hadn't planned, but the gods give you this thing suddenly in memory. There's so many known witticisms, he said, but quoted. But he was at a concert of little girls playing the piano. Some relative had forced him to go to this. And a woman sitting next to him said, why, Sir Noel, do you like music? He said, no, but I love this. Good man.
We're backstage, that they're doing a memorial for Elaine Stritch. And the woman who directed the Elaine Stritch documentary asked me, because this relates to Coward, asked me to do a little video clip for the memorial service. And I remember Elaine, in inimitable Elaine way, she said to me, you know what you should do? You should do the plays of Noel Coward. I mean, they were friends. And she said, I don't know anyone. There's this huge buildup. She goes on and on for 10 minutes. And she goes, I just don't know anyone who would do better and have more fun than you doing comedy. You were made to do comedy. This is just perfect for you.
Don't you agree?
And then she leans in and she goes, of course, you'd have to drop about 20 pounds. Because those evening clothes have to be just so. I mean, she would just pull you in and then just yank the rug out from under you.
Yeah, she was really good.
Now, our next question is, who's your favorite talk show host today? And I mean, you can answer that any way you like.
Do I look dumb enough to answer that? Hey, would you, see, I know them all. I mean, I won't, as people always say on panel shows, no matter who's mentioned, oh yes, he's a dear friend of mine. But I do know them all. I'm crazy about Colbert. He's a great friend. And I like to keep up on Stewart and Colbert. And I don't crave talk shows, but I watch some a lot. I watch a lot of them some, is what I meant to say. Would you do something daring? Would you hand me a card picked at random and without looking at it and let me see what happens? Who's got glasses? Mr. Cavett, we're here from Cleveland. Your streets are broken up and dirty. What makes New York so crummy? Tourists. Is that okay? I gotta keep that one, Alec.
You're shameless.
Okay.
I remember saying to you years ago, I said, you can't get in your box set and everything the Lester Maddox. And someone says, please discuss your interview with Truman Capote and the argument that transpired with the other guest. I think it was some right-wing politician I can't recall.
Well, he deserves that. It was Lester Maddox, the segregationist governor of... that's another show that plays like a drama.
How many people here have never seen The Cavett with Lester Maddox and...
I've never seen it. Well, don't all jump up at once.
But, oh, my God. You've got to see this.
It's incredible. I sent it to you, didn't I?
I have it, yeah.
Yeah. Go over to Alex's place.
And I'm not giving it.
He lives at... what is it again? Anyway.
Downtown.
Yeah, that was something. Yeah. Well, to leap to
you
the...
You can Google it.
Well, you talked about mixed bookings. That was a show that was asking for trouble. I didn't book it, but...
Jim Brown,
the football blitz.
Yeah, no. But I mean, the guy who was a really no holds barred, civil rights proponent.
Yeah,
You put him on with
he came on first.
Lester Maddox, and who sold pickaxe handles at his restaurant.
Yeah, he loved it when New York,
Before he became governor.
When uptown, northern papers would say the shame of shaking axe handles at black people and so on. There was some famous photograph. And I would never do that at all. They were pick handles, he said. That was a top level of his humor. But they were pick handles, so the Times was wrong. And then we also had, as a third guest, Truman Capote.
Oh, my God. You've got to see. This is like you died and went to some talk show loony bin. It's Jim Brown, Lester Maddox, and Truman Capote is there.
Hey. Why don't we come here some night? They'll put it up there, and then we'll take
questions. Let's show it.
Yeah, I said something that assumed that some people who voted for him might be bigots. And then we went to commercial. And we came back, and he said, you're going to apologize to me and the people of Georgia. I said, for what? You said all the people of Georgia were bigots. He said, the people who voted me were bigots. All the people who voted for me were bigots. And I said, no, I didn't, Governor. Cool it, that isn't what I said at all. And he insisted. And then he jumped up and looked at his Timex watch and said, I'm giving you 1 minute to apologize. And his little gleamy bald head was starting to... Oh, by the way, when he sat down, smaller considerably than Jim Brown beside him, he said, I thought you was a singer.
No. You gotta see it to believe it.
There's another Brown who sings. Anyway, so finally I just, I got annoyed as hell, and I said, okay, Governor, if I've called anyone a bigot who isn't a bigot, I apologize. Well, there was a hand, and Lester saw through that and hauled ass. I mean, walked off. And it was that was in all the papers. He claimed he got 6,000 congratulatory telegrams, and I got about as many from my side, but some suggesting I try swimming in the Yazoo River with an anchor around my neck. If you ever come down here, you know.
Well, what's amazing is to see him managing his tension, and I don't mean racist tension, I mean just his kind of hormonal tension of the Jim Brown is gonna just smack him like a handball off the wall, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That you see him,
that's
he's,
right.
He's kind of writhing in his seat, and every time Brown was here, he kept saying, yes, sir, no, sir, well, that isn't necessarily correct, sir, well, sir, the thing is, sir, well, sir, well, sir, and you feel like he's gonna just go catapulting out of the chair. Because you think that Brown's going to just dribble him like
Brown
a basketball.
Would wad him up and just
and
toss him
in
the wastebasket or dribble him across the room. Yeah.
Now, we have time for a couple more.
Oh, wait, I just say this. When he left, when he did leave, I said to Truman, I said something like, I'm sorry the governor left. You know, I hope we could talk about the beauties of the South. So I mean, stop backing down, and I'll tell you when I'm backing down, and I get mad again. And then Capote said, I went to his restaurant down in Mississippi, and his Pickwick restaurant, and I had the chicken, and it, well, it wasn't finger licking good.
That's awful.
I love Truman. He was great.
Years ago in the Times, you told a great story about first meeting with John Wayne on the set. And his quoting, no coward, is that correct, Wayne?
That was one of the shocks of my life. I know you're not supposed to like John Wayne, but I loved him as a kid, of course. There was nothing wrong with me. And Sands of Iwo Jima, my friends and I saw it 6 or 8 times, and all the John Ford Westerns and everything. And I was in a meeting about something totally unrelated on the Universal lot, I believe it was, if that's where they shot. And somebody said, oh, you know, John Wayne's over on the Western Street. And I was out of that room so fast. And when would you first see John Wayne in your dreams? On horseback, in full cowboy drag, of course. And he needed a mounting step at that point to get on a horse. I watched him shoot a scene with James Stewart about his cancer, the character's cancer, which was also Duke Wayne's at that time. Not everybody knew that. And it was thrilling. And then I went into where they were shooting an inside scene, and he said, gee, it sure is good to meet you. And my heart melted, and I didn't care anything about John Wayne except that he was John Wayne.
But is it?
And we chatted, and then, oh, yeah, I know what you were after. And
Coward.
He's so well prepared. I was humming. Well, now cut that out. I was humming, and I wasn't even aware what I was humming necessarily while they were setting up this scene. I wasn't bothering anybody. And I realized that the Duke was sitting nearby on the set waiting to go, and I was only about 10 feet from him. And he said, he was great, wasn't he? And I first wanted to say, who? I was humming, someday I'll find you moonlight behind. He said, Noel Coward. And I thought, am I gonna get anyone to believe this? And he said, yeah, I really love him. I think I've read all his plays, and people asked me to do them. If people had asked me to do them, I'd have been flattered, but I've lost his voice now. But and he said, but you know, they want me to be killing Indians, not in a dressing gown with a cigarette holder. But Wayne could have done it. And I was just astonishing to me. And I told Woody Allen, whose name has come up earlier, and he said, well, of course, he's an actor, not a cowboy. And that he was.
Yeah.
He's so moving in that film. And it was his last film.
Which one?
The Shootist.
Shootist.
And it was about an old shooter, gunslinger, with cancer. And there was a scene, another scene I got to see, where, you'll see it if you haven't, the movie, Jimmy Stewart says to him, "You want it straight, I'll tell you what you've got," he says in effect, and he does. And it almost spoiled the take when the stagehand next to me gulped and started to cry. Because they loved the Duke. I got him to do a thing on a special I did with what's-her-name, Mae West. And it was called Dick Cavett's Backlot USA. And then on my last day with the Duke, I just hung out with him for 3 days. And and old John Carradine is in the film as an undertaker. He's all in black, and he's sitting on the outdoor set with John Carradine on the back of his chair. And the Duke walked by, and I heard Carradine say, "How many is it now, Duke?" And I didn't get it at first. And he said, I think we've done 9 pictures together. And I got his autograph on a picture, and we did the scene. It was in the show. And in fact, just as before they shot, Wayne grabbed my hand mic and said, "Hi, this is John Wayne interviewing Dick Cavett." And I thought, boy, pinch me. Then it was all over, and I wasn't going to see him anymore. I got a picture autographed, and I drove about halfway home with it. And we had talked about collecting Indian artifacts and all kinds of things. And I thought, I wonder if he just wrote his name. And I pulled it out, and it said, "To Dick Cavett," I may cry, "To Dick Cavett from John Wayne." And then I pulled it the rest of the way out, and it said, "We should have started sooner." And that's why I say, when you're smiling, no.
It's interesting how, of all the people you've interviewed, rock stars and Brando, and I mean, if top to bottom, the one you get emotional about is John Wayne.
I know many of my friends were
the one you get emotional about is John Wayne.
But the emails, when you do a column online in the Times and elsewhere, you get to read the emails that come in. They publish them with it when it comes out. And I was taken to task by some. And goodbye forever, Mr. Cavett, if you like John Wayne. But quite a few that said, you know, I never could stand the son of a bitch, but I cried when you talked about when you parted and so on.
But when you're in this business and you have that fondness for people, you know, and if you ever have the chance, I mean, all the people that I would love to meet are gone. People say, "Who do you want to make a movie with?" I say, "Well, Barbara Stanwyck, who else do I want to make a movie with?"
Oh, you know? Yeah.
Elizabeth
and you better go
Taylor.
Fast because...
Yeah, Elizabeth Taylor. I mean, you don't have the same feeling for your contemporaries. And I'll never forget, I did a movie with Tony Hopkins, and he's from the same town as Burton. They're from the same town.
In Wales?
In Wales. They're from Pontrhydyfen in Port Talbot in Wales. And Tony told me that Liz Taylor said to him, they were doing some horrible, the old school... ABC movie, Monday night movie, Raid on Entebbe.
Even a B movie, a C movie.
It was a C movie, it was an ABC movie.
Yeah.
And Raid on Entebbe. And Elizabeth Taylor was in this thing, and I got a funny story about her. And she said that she was there, and she turned to Tony and she goes, "You're from Wales, right?" And he's like, yes, I am. And she was like, "Port Talbot," he said, yeah. And she said, "Pontrhydyfen?" He said, "Yeah, Pontrhydyfen, same town." And when I did the movie with Tony, we would do like dueling Burtons. We would do these Burton. We had a Burton contest. And of course, the key to it was brevity. And Tony won. He was ruled the winner of the contest with his final entry. He won with his final entry. Yeah. And he told a story about Burton. They said to Larry Harvey, "He's going to do a commercial for Courvoisier."
Oh, yeah.
And they said to Lawrence Harvey, "We want to get Burton to just say the loud, you're going to be the star of the commercial, and you're on the commercial, and you're on camera, and we want to get a really signature voice to come on at the end and just say, Courvoisier."
And they'll all know who it was.
At the end, they all knew who it was.
Yeah.
And they said, "You're going to go." He said, "Well, I happen to be going to New York to do the press junket for a Butterfield 8 with Elizabeth, and he'll be there. Cut to, he's in the hotel suite, it's noon, everybody's half in the bag already, and Larry Harvey says to Burton, please, they want you to just, they're gonna pay you like 500,000 pounds, half a million pounds or some fucking thing, and all you have to do is say one word, Courvoisier, and he said, I won't do it. No, I can't be bothered. I won't do this fucking awful thing. And he just kept exhorting him and getting drunk and more Bloody Marys and pitchers of vodka and drinking and smoking. And they're talking about plays and roles. And finally, he said, they're standing in the doorway. And Larry Harvey goes out and turns. And it's just about, they're in the doorway. And he says, Richard, please, I implore you. You only have to say one word. And Burton has his hand on the door. He goes, I won't do it because I'm too bloody big, bigger than you will ever be. And closes the door. He's drunk, and he closed the door. So for the next 3 months, I'm working with Tony Hopkins. That was the line he slapped me with.
Of course.
I'd say, are we having lunch today during the break? He'd say, no, I will never have lunch with you, because I'm too bloody big, bigger than you will ever be.
That's
when he closed, he'd mime the door in my face. And his winning entry of Burton was, we would go back and forth, and his winning entry was like a haiku. He was at the lunch table one day, and Tony Hopkins goes, Elizabeth, baubles and stones, white wine, Marbella. And he passed out in his food. And he collapsed in his lunch and passed out.
I can't get anyone to remember or believe this, but you made me think of it. He must have had a lot of alimony to pay, and the great classy James Mason, about whom Edward Albee said he was always 45 years old throughout his entire career. James Mason did a Thunderbird wine commercial. And you had to feel kind of sorry for him. It was sort of like the Wells Gallo in a Caribbean patio of palm trees and moonlight, and he's got his glass and he's alone in a white dinner jacket. And I just, I wish he were still alive so I could ask him if my hunch is true. I know you wrote for your friends, the last line of your commercial, which was, I promise you, you've never tasted anything quite like it. Oh, look.
All right, the last question, because it's almost 9 o'clock, the last question is, and I do like this question, it could go either way, but I kind of like it. What's the one thing you know?
Come again.
What's the one thing you know?
Oh, that you really know? That Dick Cheney is a prick.
Good night, everybody.